Swing Low Sweet Chariot has been synonymous with English rugby since those great waves of song first rang down from the Twickenham terraces in the mid-1980s. But Swing Low's story didn't start there. It originated on the other side of the Atlantic and has nothing at all to do with rugby. So where did it come from? What does it mean? And what do the people who represent England and represented England think of it now?
It's not a sports rallying cry. It is a religious song.
It's become a folk song. It's been adopted and adapted, which is what folk songs have always been.
Over time, things change. I think over time, things adapt. But I think it's important not to be insensitive to the original context in which it was used.
As long as you know in your heart the reasons behind why you're singing it, you've done your research, you know the roots of it, you know how it's come into rugby tradition, it's very much a personal choice for me.
If you do something and it's going to offend someone, I'd prefer not to offend anyone. If there's a different way, if there's a different path they can take.
You're not going to get one topic and the whole of the country or the whole of the rugby union family are going to be of the same opinion.
To understand the true history of Swing Low Sweet Chariot, we spoke to Josephine Wright, Professor of Music and Black Studies at the College of Worcester, Ohio.
Swing Low Sweet Chariot belongs to a group of Negro spirituals that we call alerting songs. In other words, they were coded messages. They had several different meanings. They would have been used as songs on the underground, that is the network of safe houses in which slaves would use to escape from slavery. And they would also be used as burial songs. And I know that there is an anecdote that has spread throughout Great Britain that Willis Wallace, a slave of the Choctaw in Indian Territory, Oklahoma, was the originator of that song. I've had people tell me, I don't know what I'm talking about, that the song was not a slave song. And what it's saying to me is they really don't understand the nature of slavery in the United States and the porous nature of slave culture. Because my ancestors on my mother's side, six generations ago, were conceived as legally as chattel, to be bartered, to be sold, to be mortgaged. And therefore, in slave life and culture, families were disrupted at a moment's notice. And as those families were disseminated throughout the slave South, so what were these songs? And there is documentation in the slave narratives from Mississippi, where the Choctaw come, that songs like Swing Low Sweet Chariot were in the oral literature during slavery. It documents a very dark period in U.S. history when we had a peculiar institution that degraded a group of people and made them subhuman beings. It was a period of overt white supremacy. And after slavery, the stereotypes that were created by slave owners to justify their enslavement of my ancestors didn't die out.
So how did a song that originated during one of the bleakest and most forlorn periods in cultural memory become associated with rugby union at all? The answer lies in the 1950s cross-Atlantic folk music revival.
I'd gone to this rugby dinner in the February of 1959, and after all the dirty songs had been sung and all the rugby songs had been sung, I suddenly burst into singing folk songs, Kumbaya, Michael Rose Bedershaw, and then I sang Swing Low Sweet Chariot, because I'd heard Odetta sing it on the BBC programme at Christmas just gone.
Joe Stead passed away in March 2017, so we spoke to his friend and publisher, Pete Haywood.
He was a genial giant. He was nearly Captain Birdseye at one time. He got through to the audition. He was the last two in the audition for that. He's been on programmes like Emma Dale and the likes, because as a working folk musician, sometimes you have spare time to do things. It was just his character. But his school days, he was mad keen on rugby. He met Paul Robeson when he was a teenager. Now, Paul Robeson coming over from America at that time, you know, it would be a big thing for a teenager to meet somebody like that. It's like us meeting Nelson Mandela. You know, he'd know he was somebody special. And he was at some garden party that he was invited to, again, through music. But the person who was organising it said, you know, come over and meet Paul Robeson. And it was like, who, me?
Sing Low Sweet Chariot is such an easy song to learn anyway. So whether I introduced it to the rugby world or not, I like to think I did.
From the 1960s onwards, Swing Low Sweet Chariot has been sung in community rugby clubs. It's been sung at Twickenham too, but more often in the bar than from the terrace. That was until 1987, when a young up-and-coming player called Martin Afire helped his team to the final of the Middlesex Sevens.
I say the whole Chariots of Fire, Swing Low thing, it was something that it happened, but I'm only hearing about it secondhand. I was there, but I was not really aware of what was happening around me, because I didn't even know that my nickname was Chariots. People, when I tried to explain them where it came from, I say I didn't give myself that name. The only reason I even knew about it was because I saw it written down in a paper. They did a photo shoot with me dressed up in a Roman centurion's outfit, Chariots and the whole Chariots of Fire thing. I just think I don't even know how it began, you know, obviously because of the film, which was quite prevalent of the time, and it was about running and my name, and, you know, I suppose that's how the name Chariots of Fire stuck. And no one really knows how something starts, but, you know, it just appeared. When I learned about the song, the history of the song and how it was, a song, you know, sung about death, really, at funerals. You know, it was about slaves and disenfranchised African Americans who were trying to lift themselves up, I suppose, really, and, you know, to think that they'll go into a better place and they'll, you know, there'll be better days ahead, and a song of aspiration. You know, so you can take positives from anything. You can take positives or negatives from any situation, but I always choose to take the positive from it. And you know, whether it's sung, you know, and I've heard it sung on many occasions, and I've been at Twickenham on many occasions and watched many England games since I've retired. And you know, the only thing fills me with a sense of you know, upliftment, even now that I know the history of the song. And you can't rip it from the fabric of English rugby, because it just, English rugby wouldn't be English rugby. It is what it is, the same way that you cannot rip the African-American experience away from America. You know, America is what it is. You know, English rugby is what it is. England is what it is. And if you try to do that, you would only cause negativity and resentment, and you'd make it divisive. So, you know, you have to embrace your history, good and bad. And I think that's what we have to do as, you know, as a nation, as a code of rugby, that being rugby union, or you want to look at rugby as a whole.
The following year, Swing Low rang out as Chris Oatey scored 3 of England's 5 second half tries against Ireland. Since then, it has followed England home and away as a rallying call. Most England players grew up with it. But with such a complicated history, what do they think now?
The first time I kind of came across the song, Swing Low, was as a student playing rugby. So obviously it's the usual kind of student songs, an opportunity to be a bit rude, a bit naughty, a bit of fun in the post-bar match, really. It was more about just post-match celebration, really. And then later on, it was sitting at Twickenham at the stadium, you know, obviously booming it out the same as anyone else when there's something cool happened on the pitch, or, you know, the crowd kind of rising up and singing together, which was an incredible feeling for anyone who's been to any stadium globally, you know, and you're kind of singing a song that celebrates something your team does on the pitch. I never really thought about its origins before this current discussion, you know, that Black Lives Matter has brought up all sorts of discussions and all sorts of questioning about the origin of our songs, our you know, all of our stuff that's celebrated around us, statues, you know, many, many things. And it's interesting that this song has become a part of that conversation. And it's suddenly like, oh, of course, yes. It's like, and it's so ingrained in our culture, in our rugby culture, that it was almost startling to realise that actually that maybe for me, maybe it doesn't belong. Maybe we shouldn't use it. Like, and so I was really battling in my mind as to whether I would sing it again. And that's what kept coming up in my mind after reading lots of stuff. And the bottom line for me was, if I was sitting in Twickenham, would I feel comfortable singing the song now? Now, knowing what I know now, and I probably wouldn't sing it. A little bit of me would feel a bit sad because we've lost a bit of that celebration. But equally, I'd feel happier with myself not singing that, not singing Swing Low, because it feels like it's a misappropriation of somebody else's song and somebody else's celebration, you know, and the slaves that created that song and the slave underground that used the song and those words, and they mean so much more than our fun, you know, and a bit of rugby. And of course, rugby is really important. It was a major part of my life, but it just seems so much more. So I think I wouldn't sing it, you know, that's what I think. And hearing it, what would it make me feel like? I don't know, probably a little bit sad, but perhaps we should look for other things to celebrate our rugby culture, you know, and we, to some extent, in my opinion, we've misappropriated that song. And we do that through culture in lots of different things. And that's one of our things at rugby that we've done, you know, and we have to, it's great that we're having the conversation. It's great that fans are having conversation, that the rugby union's having that conversation. And globally, you know, everyone has to look at all the bits and pieces that we've done in the past. Just because we've done it in the past doesn't mean it's right. And we should just look at things again with our new knowledge and then make a decision now going forward based on that. Yes, it was great. Yes, it was fun. Yes, there are some amazing memories from it for me, but I don't think I would sing it again at Twickenham. I'd find another way to celebrate.
I just feel as if the contexts are so different, and the previous context is such a sensitive issue and a sensitive topic to a lot of people. And it almost feels to sing the song in the context that is sung in England, it's taken out of context massively. I think predominantly most people who sing the song Swing Low don't sing it with any, you know, malice. I don't think they sing it with any intent to harm or, you know, cause other people ill feeling. However, that doesn't deny that the origins of where that song came from is, you know, deeply spiritual, and it does have racial undertones to it. For me, personally, I think what I would like to see is a greater education around the meaning of the song, a greater understanding of the original context in which the song was you know, made and sang in. It was sang in funerals. It was sang in the fields of African Americans during slavery. Understand the original meaning of the song. And I think once people understand that, they can come to their own conclusion. I'm not gonna sit here and tell people what they should and shouldn't do. But personally, I won't be singing the song anymore. I've sung the song previously when I was naive to the original context. But given what I know about the original context of Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, I think it's, personally, that's not the song I'll be singing anymore when I'm a part of England or in the fans. when I'm a fan watching England play.
As long as it's not being sung to offend someone, it's not being said to make someone feel small or to make someone feel little or belittle someone, sometimes it's okay to keep up with tradition and sing what comes to mind and your heart. So it's so, so personal, and it's very much personal preference. It's not for me to judge. It's not for anyone else to judge for anyone sings it. For me, it's about as long as you know in your heart the reasons behind why you're singing it, you've done your research, you know the roots of it, you know how it's come into rugby tradition, it's very much a personal choice for me. And if somebody sung it to me on the pitch, or while I was on the pitch, not necessarily to me, but while I was on the pitch, like I'm not just going to sit down and down tools and not play rugby anymore, because in that situation, it's not meant in a bad way. It's more of a celebration. It's the camaraderie. It's the fact that everyone knows it. And sometimes it just adds to the atmosphere, which can be a positive thing. It's the English language in general, right? It means what you want it to mean sometimes. And one word in one situation could be very different coming from somebody else in another situation. So it's situation dependent. It's person dependent. It's intent dependent. And just as much of the English language is how you use it, but also having the knowledge and the backing behind it. So it's knowing where the origins of words or phrases or sentences or songs come from, and almost respecting that, and then making your own informed decisions as to whether to use it, whether to say it, whether to refer to these things, and in what context.
I don't think anything needs to be done about the singing of the song Swing Low. I just think we just need to talk and educate ourselves. You know, the England fans are going to do what the England fans are going to do. And I, for one, you know, if they're going to sing the song after and one, we'll be singing the song with them. I know that there are players who feel differently. You're not going to get one topic and the whole of the country or the whole of the rugby union family are going to be of the same opinion. And as I say, these things, you know, I didn't give myself the name Chariots. We didn't prescribe the England fans to sing this song, so you can't prescribe them to not sing that song. It's going to happen, and you just got to let things happen organically. We must tell these stories. We must talk about the uncomfortable things of our past, like where the song came from. It came from, you know, slaves singing about death and a brighter future in death, in heaven. We must talk about, you know, the uncomfortable truths of what happened in 1895, which led to the split of the coast. We must talk about all the uncomfortable things in our past and then go on with love in our hearts. And that's all I can say, really.
The song perhaps gives us the opportunity to look at that period of history again and acknowledge the you know, the brutality and the tragic nature of it. Is that an upside to the fact that this song has entered into this particular sporting community in England?
Absolutely. Because if we do not understand the past, we will continue to repeat it. I think it's an opportunity, not just for you in the UK, but for us in the United States as well, to rethink how we treat other people. Anytime we talk honestly about race relationships and we do not sweep under the rug unpopular facts, that we make progress. It's when we cherry pick history, we suppress information, and we half educate our youth, that we promote the kind of racism that we are seeing now in the millennium.
The recent movements that we've seen over the last couple of months have shown that there is a lot of work to be done. You know, we're still not there in terms of racial equality, we're still not there in terms of racial injustice. So I think as a society, there definitely is a lot of work to be done. Rugby has a responsibility to lead the way in that. Yeah, you know, rugby as a whole has this reputation of being, you know, a middle class white sport. And you know, obviously I'm a black person who plays rugby. I think a third of the England team at the moment of different backgrounds, and I think that's a great thing, and I think that should be celebrated. And I think rugby has a responsibility to fight racial injustice where they see it, and also promote diversity within the game. Because even looking at it from a purely performance point of view, the more diverse and wide your playing pool, you have more players to pick from. Competition is stronger, and it will ultimately lead to a stronger England team.
There are many issues that rugby needs to address, and we all know what they are. There are many black players who have played for England over the years and have played the sport at club and county level. I believe there's only Maggie Alfonsi, who is part of the the RFU committee. You know, things like that needs to change. There needs to be, in rooms of meritocracy, they must show society in its fullest and richest. And those are the things that I think are more important to discuss than whether we sing a song or not.